assisted by Deacon John. Today is the second Sunday in ordinary time. So that our worship may be focused on the Lord, please silence all electronic devices at this time. I will now read a prayer for peace, strength, and healing during this time of pandemic. Loving God, we come to you full of anxiety about what may happen in the coming days and weeks. Shower us with the peace Jesus promised to his disciples, and make us into steady pillars for those around us. In this time of uncertainty and epidemic, wake us up to the reminder that we are not alone. Even as we are asked to keep our distance from others, help us to find ways to reach out to those who need our support. We pray especially for those whose incomes and livelihoods are threatened, for the children who will miss meals due to school closures, for those already isolated, lonely, and scared. Loving God, give them your peace, and through our hands, ensure they have what they need. Sustain, strengthen, and protect all caregivers. Bless them as they offer compassion and care, and show selfless courage in the face of risk. Remind us each time we wash our hands that in our baptism, you call us to let go of our fears and live in joy, peace, and hope. Amen.
We glorify you. We acknowledge your great glory.
of Samuel. Samuel was sleeping in the temple of the Lord, where the ark of God was. The Lord called to Samuel, who answered, "Here I am." Samuel ran to Eli and said, "Here I am, you called me." "I did not call you," Eli said. "Go back to sleep." So he went back to sleep. Again, the Lord called Samuel, who rose and went to Eli. "Here I am," he said, "you called me." But Eli answered, "I did not call you, my son. Go back to sleep." At that time, Samuel was not familiar with the Lord, because the Lord had not revealed anything to him as yet. The Lord called Samuel again for the third time. Getting up and going to Eli, he said, "Here I am. You called me." Then Eli understood that the Lord was calling the youth. So he said to Samuel, "Go to sleep, and if you are called, reply, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.'" When Samuel went to sleep in his place, the Lord came and revealed his presence, calling out as before, "Samuel, Samuel." Samuel answered, "Speak, for your servant is listening." Samuel grew up, and the Lord was with him, not permitting any word of his to be without effect. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our responsorial song, "Hear My Lord, I Come to Do Your Will." I have waited for the Lord, and he stooped toward me and heard my cry. And he put a new song into my mouth, a hymn to our God.
Hear my Lord, I come to do your will.
Sacrifice or offering you wished not, but ears open to obedience you gave me. Holocausts or sin offerings you sought not. Then said I, "Behold, I come." Hear my Lord, I come to do your will. In a written scroll it is prescribed for me, to do your will, O my God, is my delight, and your law is within my heart.
Hear my Lord, I come to do your will.
I announced your justice in the vast assembly. I did not restrain my lips, as you, O Lord, know. A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, the body is not for immortality, but for the Lord, and the Lord is for the body. God raised the Lord and will also raise us by his power. Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ? But whoever is joined to the Lord becomes one spirit with him. Avoid immorality. Every other sin a person commits is outside the body, but the immoral person sins against his own body. Do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, whom you have from God, and that you are not your own? For you have been purchased at a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. John was standing with two of his disciples, and as he watched Jesus walk by, he said, "Behold the Lamb of God." The two disciples heard what he had said and followed Jesus. Jesus turned and saw them following him and said to them, "What are you looking for?" They said to him, "Rabbi," which translated means teacher. "Where are you staying?" they asked. He said to them, "Come and you will see." So they went and saw where Jesus was staying, and they stayed with him that day. It was about 4 in the afternoon. Andrew, the brother of Simon Peter, was one of the two who heard John and followed Jesus. He first found his own brother Simon and told him, "We have found the Messiah," which is translated Christ. Then he brought him to Jesus. Jesus looked at him and said, "You are Simon, the son of John. You will be called Cephas," which is translated Peter. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Forget it. And so so I would go back to sleep for a year or two. Then I would hear, get that feeling again like Samuel did, where he said, you called me, and then he said, I didn't call you. And that's how I would feel, like, he didn't call me. And so this went on for 5, 6, 7 years, I guess. And then finally, eventually, I got to the part where it says, speak where your servant is listening. But I had a hard time coming to that decision. And I think, well, I know from dealing with people throughout the years, many people have a difficult time sort of responding to the Lord's call in their life. So often we hold back, but we're free to make a move. We're free to make a decision. Or we're free to. And I was a school counselor 6 years from college level, 13 at high school. And I would have no idea how many young people would come in and say, well, I'm a sophomore or junior or whatever, or ready to graduate. I don't know what I want to do in my life. And they'd be just totally confused. And I used to try to calm them down and say, well, many people I know in life, they didn't know what they wanted to do. I didn't know what I wanted to do. And we have to then just keep trying to let God's voice, lack of a better word, come into our lives and then respond to it eventually in some way or another. And I know that I have many a person throughout the year come and say that it really helped them because they felt that here when they were 19, 20 years old, they didn't know what they wanted to do. They felt life was passing them by and there won't be failures. But they kept trying to come to that decision of what to do in their life. And it was not easy. Like, I look at examples right now. I know a number of doctors that were students when they came through school who were concurrent with a number of them. And some of them are retired now already. But I don't remember them. They had no idea they wanted to be a doctor until sometime they were out of college. And all at once, then they started, for one reason or another, started going toward their ultimate vocation. I look back at my life, and I'm going to give a soul searching here. I'll be truthful, I think I'm glad that I had to go through a hard time. Because when the day came and then I made that decision, I was sure that I wanted to do. And I've always thought I was a better priest because of the fact that at a hard time I really come into a decision on what to do with my life. And I bring this up for a couple of reasons. There may be somebody here right now who's a little discouraged. They're trying to make a decision in life, but they just don't know what to do, and they're afraid. Or they feel they should do something, but they're hesitant to do it. Or maybe some of you right now who are dealing with maybe one of your children or grandchildren, and they're going through a problem like this, that they just don't know what they want to do with life, that they're confused. Maybe your encouragement to help them, let them know that it's not unusual at all not to know what we want to do. That sometimes we have to try to do 3 different times. And I'm sure some of you right now can relate to that. I'm sure some of you have ended up in a vocation or a job that you didn't really know about as a younger person. But then things evolved, and finally you decided what you wanted to do, and you were happy about it. I remember back when I was trying to make up my decision for priesthood, I used to tell myself, well, go on and try it then. If you quit, like you hear in seminary, if you quit, then at least you know that it's not for you. And that was sort of a little negative psychology there for a while in my own life. And I'm sure some of you have done that also in your life. You've made a decision with saying, well, at least if it doesn't work, I know it doesn't work, and I want something else. So I look at this particular reading from Samuel. It's meant a lot to me. And I bring it up to you for a number of reasons. If there's one person in church this evening that maybe I can encourage, not to get discouraged about the fact that you are having a hard time making a decision, then, but this might encourage you to realize that life has not passed you by, that there's still opportunities to make those decisions that you might thought that that were behind you. Or as I mentioned a little while ago, there might be some of you who could encourage someone else to let them know that life is not easy. We don't always know what we want to do. And there's so many opportunities, and sometimes we don't know which it is that God has called us to, that we have to have a little trust, a little faith, and not be afraid to make a decision, not be afraid to really trust in God. And so I look at Samuel today, which he keeps saying, I'll wait, or said, go back to sleep. And finally, when he realized that the Lord was talking to him, and he said, speak, I'm listening. I just encourage each of you, if you might be having difficulty, some of you maybe right now have a decision about something that you would like to do or think you should do, but you don't. Maybe just don't have the courage to try it. You're a little bit afraid. Don't be afraid to make those decisions. Trust in God. Trust that you'll get the inspiration, or you get the Holy Spirit to guide you and to direct you. I know I'm repeating this a little bit, but I do recall back in my days as a school counselor, how many young people really felt life was passing them by because they didn't really know they're reaching an age where they felt they should have everything under control, but they didn't have it under control. But so often then, eventually, when they found out what they really want to do, then it works out for them and they find a sense of happiness. I've often felt that I would not have been the same priest I am today or advised me if I had gone to seminary right at the start. Looking back, I'm sure glad that I did the things I did in college and the army and all that kind of stuff. And at the time, I thought maybe life was passing me by. And I realized it wasn't. That we're called upon sometimes to have a hard time coming up with the proper decision in our life. So, some of these thoughts I just sort of randomly share with you might make some sense to some of you. And if I reach one or two people, then I felt that had a pretty good day's work. So look at this reading sometime from Samuel. Samuel feels that the Lord's calling. He says, here I am. And the Lord says, I'm not ready. But eventually, he hangs in there, and eventually he says, here I am, Lord, your servant is listening. Think about that sometime, as I mentioned a little while ago. There might be some of you guiding one of your children or your grandchildren or someone you have some relationship with to help them realize that just because at a time in their life when they think that they should have everything under control, that it's not always the way it works. And often, the fact that they had to struggle to come up with what they wanted to do in the long run makes them a more productive person, makes them a more happy person, and makes more sure of the fact that you really are listening when the Lord calls.
God, the God not made, consubstantial of the Father. Through all judge the living and the dead.
His kingdom will have no end.
I believe in the Holy Spirit,
the Lord, the giver of life,
who proceeds from the Father and the Son of God,
who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified,
who has spoken through the prophets.
I believe in one holy
Catholic and Apostolic Church.
I confess one
baptism for the forgiveness of sins. And I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us for now place our peace and our care in the hands of the Father.
For the Church, may we strive to break down barriers that divide. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our leaders who have responded to the call to serve others in public office, that they may work humbly and tirelessly to serve the common good. We pray to the Lord. That all of our citizens may work to hasten the day when this country truly lives out the ideas for which Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. fought and gave his life. We pray to the Lord. For those who are struggling to hear the Lord's voice in their lives or understand the nature of their call, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all of those who suffer the consequences of the current pandemic, that God the Father may grant health to the sick, strength to those who care for them, comfort to the families, and salvation to all of the victims who have died. We pray to the Lord. For the sick, may they know recovery from their illness and relief from pain, especially Dolores Barnett, and for all of the prayer intentions listed in the book in the vestibule of the church. We pray to the Lord. For those who have died, may they rest forever in the eternal happiness of heaven, especially John East, parishioner. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all of the intentions recommended to our parish, in particular those of this Mass, for Ted Harding, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We now pause to add our own intentions, which we hold in our hearts. We pray to the Lord.
Lord,
as we come together this evening, asking for your blessing, especially this day, that your Holy Spirit guide and direct those who are maybe making personal decisions about how to live Grant us, we pray, grant us the Lord, we pray, that we may participate worthily in these mysteries, or whatever the memorial of this sacrifice is celebrated, the work of our redemption is accomplished through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. Grant compassion for the waywardness that is ours, and humble themselves as vulnerable and worthy. By the passion of the cross, he freed us from unending death. By rising from the dead, he gave us life eternal. So with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, with all of the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, and without end we acclaim. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity. Together with Francis, our Pope Joseph, our Archbishop, all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on all, we pray, with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, and with Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit the co-heir of eternal life and praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. For it is through him, with him, and him, in unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor be yours forever and ever. Glorify us, O Lord, the spirit of your love. In your kindness, make those who are nourished by this one heavenly bread, one in mind and heart, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Monday, January 18th, Mass will be held at 9 a.m. Mondays for Martin Luther King. Also, the parish office and school will be closed on Monday, January 18th.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let's give Paul the sympathy upon our own lives and would like to conclude our prayer. May the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit descend upon us, all those of whom we have heart, and remain with us forever.
Amen. Our Mass is ended. Let us now go forth in peace to love and serve our Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Good side.